Though the sun always shone on the mountains of Philly, the winds and the waves never came. To call the place beautiful, no one would quibble, though heard of the feet they exclaim. But high in those hills past the walls of the road, so high that the clouds were below, sat two tiny towns, though nothing but trouble. If you listen, you'll see that it's so.
Now the town of the West that thought it was best bore the name Liberalism, where women and men since 1710 have worn on their head one large shoe. Now in the town number two, one big shoe wouldn't do, so the people of Liberty Lot would look down and bell at shoe-handed fellows wore on their heads one at a time. For days without end, these two towns would bicker about whose headgear was best. The shoes and the pots would fly without end, from morning to night without rest.
But not all of these people who lived in these cities were angry and bitter and vile. A few who read poems and sang happy deeds and greeted all their friends with joy. Both Bolivian fellows who hated to fight tried climbing to the apple and lobster. As pots clashed around her from morning to night, she just prayed for a pet one of lobster. They kept to themselves and they talked and they talked to the one who said,
"Hey, let's go for a walk. I'm tired of lying around like a squid. I want to get out there."
So that's what they did. The shoe-headed girl and her blue-plastered friend walked out from their town and began to descend to the dark, rocky valley between the two cities, away from her friends and their light-hearted ditties.
"Hey, this is swell. Gosh, this is fun. I'm glad that my lobster could get out and run."
But neither the toy nor the girl with the shoe could see the disaster about to ensue. For up in the rocks, just out of sight, were four beady eyes full of anger and spite. Four beady eyes watched our hero meander, one wicked crook and a shifty commander.
"Well, what more good fortune,"
the nasty one said.
"Here comes a poor girl with a shoe on her head.
I bet she's got money, I bet she's got gold, or maybe some jewelry she wants us to hold.
Whatever the booty I think I can stand it, why that's what I live for, that's why I'm a bandit."
And then they attacked us from under their rock. First they knocked off a shoe, then they knocked off a sock. But the thing they did next was extremely unfunny. Why, they shook her so hard she dropped her milk.
"Hey!"
she protested.
"I don't like your ilk. How must I go strong if I don't drink my milk?"
But they didn't care. They'd accomplished their goal. So they put our friend down and stuck her head in the hole. And walked off with their money. Every last night, they yelled back as they left.
"See you around, silly pickle,"
then she said in a moan.
"Well, I guess I'm alone."
But this was a loneliness she'd never known. Her friends were far off and her lobster was missing. The sound she could hear was just the wind. Things looked pretty grim for our Flidian buddy. Her head in a hole, her shoe bent and muddy. But then, were those footsteps? Could it be true? Along came the mayor, Liberaloo. If anyone, surely she helped the poor soul.
"Hello,"
said the girl with her head in the hole.
"I seem to be fallen. I seem to be stuck. But now that you're here, I guess I'm in luck."
"Oh dear,"
said the mayor, observing the shoe.
"A fellow in need, and she's Libyan too. Young girl, I've noticed your dire situation, and please rest assured that I share your frustration. But how can I put this? Oh, what can I say? Maybe you'll understand better this way."
Then they looked at each other and said with a smile,
"Oh, hey,
Thank you.